coming. If you don't know, I'm Chuck Preston, senior curator here at the Buffaloville Historical Center and curator of the Draper Museum of Natural History. And it is truly a distinct pleasure for me today to introduce our speaker. We've been working together on a project for the last several years, and I've gotten to know him pretty well. And I know that he'll have some pretty interesting adventures to share with you. Let me tell you a little bit about him. He spent most of his adult life here in Wyoming, lived in Cody for a good part of that time. He grew up in Indiana, and like a lot of us interested in natural history, biology, he spent a good deal of his time sort of rambling around local places in Indiana and around the family farm. And he knew early on, and I don't think he and I had talked about this, but both of us had the same kind of idea in mind, that maybe we'd be a game warden or a ranger. I mean, that was my primary goal early on in life as well, so it was his. He did graduate with a Bachelor of Arts degree in biology from Hanover College. In 1976, he began a backcountry career, and that's a good deal of what he's going to talk about today. As a volunteer on the trail crew out in Sunlight Ranger District of the Shoshone National Forest, and then in 1982, he was commissioned as a National Park Service law enforcement ranger in Yellowstone. He's worked in almost every district of Yellowstone as a backcountry ranger, also as a wilderness ranger for Shoshone National Forest. In 85, he was recruited by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service Division of Law Enforcement. He worked in Chicago and Miami. That should be interesting. Investigating international smuggling of wildlife. I worked actually undercover for a short time in New Orleans doing the same thing as when I was actually a professor at Arkansas. So we should share some of those things in a row too. And that was a good deal of fun. If I have some stories, I bet you have some great ones. But of course he was put behind a desk for a while, and that didn't agree with him, I suspect. And so he left that and returned to Yellowstone. In the early 90s, he worked at Lake Clark National Park in Alaska as well. So after all these experiences, he's still not retired. Like most of us, he probably can't afford it. Since the Park Service offered few, and he didn't want to anyway, but since Park Service offers few permanent backcountry ranger positions with retirement, most recently, he's been working with me on the Golden Eagle Research Project, and is both a pilot, which is, we wouldn't be able to do that project without Richard. I mean, he's been the glue that's held that part together, because it's so much depends on aerial surveys. And as a research assistant, especially with mapping and using GIS system, which he's very well acquainted with. He's also working for the Western Alliance of Fish and Wildlife Agencies, mapping the history of bighorn sheep translocation. So with all of that, please welcome Richard Jones. Richard, let me jump in one other time just for one thing that I forgot to mention. Thank you, Bonnie. If you have cell phones, please do turn them off at this point, because we don't want that yet. Okay. So here we go. Thank you.
Well, I do appreciate y'all coming today, and I'm glad you clapped, because I was like kind of getting in front, because I was just over you might not be. Let me get the cell phone for a moment, too. That would be embarrassing. All right, I think that's off. Anyway, I'd like to thank Chuck and the Draper Museum of Natural History and the BBHC for asking me here today, but you know, it kind of reminds me of, well, you really should be careful what you ask for. And I'd also like to thank Emily Buckles and my wife, Mary Robinson, for helping me kind of try to whittle this thing down. So I guess it's up to me now. You know, and Kevin mentioned something about a shock collar. I was thinking that this morning. I should be wearing a shock collar, and Emily or Mary, every time I get to rambling too long, she could give me a jolt, would have this program a little shorter. But and I have this chair up here, and I'm going to sit in it. So. But I just didn't want you to get worried that I was going to toss an empty chair like Clint Eastwood. But I know I've probably talked to quite a few empty chairs in my days, and empty space, and a lot of horses and mules, because part of being a backcountry ranger is, at least when I was doing it, you just spent a lot of time out in the hills alone. And and said, I had some pretty good conversations back there, and that was for cell phone and Skype people. So. It went better. That piece of technology was that little flipper thing. And I had a lot of time to give this talk without all these pictures, and hopefully I won't forget what I'm going to talk about. But anyway, I call this a ramble, because, you know, a ramble's kind of, you know, you're just kind of out, not really having a schedule, you're not really looking at anything particular, just kind of seeing what's interesting. And I really wasn't very good on schedules anyway. You know, I was kind of, my schedule was more dictated by weather and how high the creeks were, or how deep the snow was. And my supervisor really didn't appreciate that also much a lot of times. And probably one of the reasons I never really could hold down a full-time job. And also, you know, I always thought, you know, they hired me, you know, because I do what I do. Then I'd get to work, and then I found out that they were wanting me to do what they wanted to do. And I usually did what I wanted to do, and that's another reason I probably never held down a full-time job. But I also use the word explore in there. And you know, if you know where you're going to go, what you're going to see, when you're going to get back, well, that's not too much like a sport. So I just kind of want to give you a fair warning, and I can get to going on, and this, here it is, 25 after 12. So if you've got, you know, you've got promises to keep this afternoon, and Miles right before his sleep, if you have to, you know, head out of here before we get finished, then I understand. And if I'd had that shock collar, we would have probably ended up earlier, but I'm going to have a little break in between these parts. That first part probably will take me as much as almost 30 minutes, so that might be a place to escape to. You know, I think Mark Twain said that you know, getting talked to death was not a really pretty way to go. So I want you guys to do that. All right, let's see what we got here. Like Chuck was saying, I grew up in Indiana, and I spent a lot of time out in family farms and big deciduous forests. There's a lot of biodiversity. There's an old spring on our farm, and there's my mother mushroom hunting, and those were good days. And Chuck pretty much went over my history and stuff, so I'm not going to go into that too much. But one thing, my grandfather lived down here on the farm, and he lived in this old frame house that my father was actually born in. And they never had plumbing in that, and my dad just got electricity in it, not when I was built. I'd be an electrician after World War II. And they'd be sitting there visiting, and actually this table right here, that table, is the one my grandfather would sit his pipe on. And they'd be visiting, and there was a picture there on the wall. And I sat there like that, and I said, I just think it was choked up like this. Well, I'd like to see that someday. You know, as I imagine, he just cut that out of a little cabinet. I don't even know if it had glass in the frame or anything, but that was a picture. I wish I had that picture. But that's all about it. You know, I did get started up satellite working trails, and then I built some skills and worked in Yellowstone, and Chuck had very much over that. But you know, sometimes, especially getting these talks and folks aren't familiar with what park rangers do, they go, oh, you know, what's park ranger do? Hard to put words sometimes because it's just kind of a kid, you know. And so, but I guess in general, you know, we were given a pretty big chunk of very special country just to be, you know, trying to be the best steward as we could. And with, you know, with what we could do out there. And then there'd be folks out there enjoying backcountry. Sometimes it's get themselves in a jam. I could go on a lot. There's a lot of funny stories and some not so funny stories about folks getting themselves in a real jam right there. So, you know, we'd be there to kind of help them out. And then sometimes folks would be a little careless and after a little education. And then there'd be some folks that just pretty much had a total disregard for how special these places were. And they'd come in poaching and tearing the place up. And I tell you what, those are the guys that I really enjoyed getting out. It was kind of fun. It was kind of like, I used to really enjoy elk hunting and deer hunting, but it's about as much fun as anything to hunt with folks like that, because we're usually pretty good adversaries. And so it's a pretty good game out there. But one of the you know, like I said earlier, one of the things about being a backcountry ranger is that, at least when I did, is you spent a lot of time alone out there. And these are some of the blue yellow boxes at some of the places I was a backcountry in Yellowstone and then up in Alaska there. And these are some of the things you do as a ranger. Now see those chaps that fellow's wearing there? That's these chaps. I don't think it's the same human being, but they fit a lot better than that guy. In the wintertime, sometimes we go back and do track surveys and shovel roofs off the cabins, and I'll get up here and point at some of this stuff. I kind of feel like Buffalo Bill. That little stage they got up there in the Buffalo Bill Museum. I kind of feel like that. I don't get to wear the stuff much anymore, so I'm going to wear it. But here's some grizz tracks on that outhouse. And I can tell you some other stories about grizzly bears and outhouses. But I'm not going to do that now. That's pretty good. I don't know if anybody was in there or not. And this is a friend of mine, Dennis Clayton. He's the husband of Ann Bellman. And some of you might know. Dennis and I were skiing out of Heart Lake one morning, and it was 19 below zero, and I looked over, and Dennis looked a little frosty there. But this is some time up in Lamar, and I was getting to where I was going to talk about being alone a lot. And there was one time I came back from Miami, and boy, it was just like, you know, quitting beating your head against the wall. It just was so nice. And I put 1,100 miles on my horses that season in 1987. And in September, I was out on a 10-day hitch. And that's normally what we'd go out on, a 10-day hitch with a horse and a pack horse. And we would work some out of these backcountry cabins. And they'd have food caches in them. And in September, I'd be more up on the boundary between the forest and the park, just to kind of keep an eye out for folks coming in the park, the coach. So you're pretty remote areas. Well, I got word that all the folks back on the district have to go to a fire in California. Now, that's kind of aggravating, because I'd like to go on a fire, and kind of adventure. So I just decided, well, my 10 days up, I'm just going to stay. I'm not coming out. So I ended up staying out there 25 days. Without coming out, all by myself. The only people I saw, I was coming down Miller Creek and hitting the Lamar River Trail, going up towards Cold Creek and Frost Lake, and I ran a couple backpackers, and this was in about 5 minutes. In about 25 days, that's the only folks I saw, and I probably traveled a couple hundred miles. Well, you know, I would like to do that. That was something I'd like to do. Again, the same fellows were my chefs. Then another time, I spent a long time alone. I've worked in the summer times at Lake Clark National Park for the Park Service, and in the winter times, a couple times, I worked for this gentleman here, Jay Hammond, and he was the governor of Alaska during the pipeline years. And he and Bella, his wife there, and she was a Native American Inuit, and they'd head out for all 2 or 3 months. This winter, they were gone for about 3 months. And I'd watch their boys kind of hold down the fort and kind of watch their dogs. This little dog here, his name was Zook. And I guess that meant dog in Inuit. I was there about 8 or 9 weeks that winter, and I only saw a person for 5 minutes. The guy was coming up, could bring me my mail, and I handed him. He took off, and that's all I saw for about 9 weeks of humans, which I'd do that again, too. It's pretty nice, really. But when Jay came back, we flew up to see deck training. Anybody read one of those books or seen a PBS show about deck training Gilroy Kelsey's cabin up in Alaska? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So old Jay and I, Jay and I flew up, and there's Dick Prenicky, and there's Governor Hammond. Man, and Jay's playing there on Twin Lakes, and there's Dick and Jay over there, and there's Dick's cabin. And kind of talking about inspirational folks. I mean, these two gentlemen were probably, you know, they're just really significant sources of inspiration for me. These guys really had a deep appreciation for the natural world and really what it took to take care of. And I'm just so honored and grateful that I got to spend a fair amount of time with these two gentlemen. They're both gone now. But you can't really talk about inspiration and natural resources and things without mentioning, well, it's beautiful. And this quote here stuff with me way back, a long time ago. And comes to mind quite often. But in these backcountry cabins, there'd be a backcountry law. And you'd write down in there what you did, what you saw, what needed to be done. And these are really great historical documents. In fact, down in Thoroughfare, there's a logbook that's got Bob Marshall's signature in it. And Larry Luckinbill's father, Frank Luckinbill, I can't remember, of Crandall, had taken Bob Marshall into Thoroughfare. And that was pretty special to see Bob Marshall. Right. But anyway, this was in 1983. That was 30 years ago. I can't believe. That's scary. That wasn't that long ago, and 30 more years. Oh, I didn't think I was going to live this long. And so me and my man Gary Polson packing rations into the cabins. And you can probably read Gary's writing, because I can't read my writing very good. I read here, in from Soda Butte, which meant Soda Butte Trailhead. And it said, drop grain and rations at Calfee Creek, which is another cabin, Calfee Creek Cabin. And Coal Creek's up here in the upper Lamar, Calfee Creek's about halfway, and then Miller Creek's up in here, another cabin, and then Cache Creek's another cabin up in here. And so we'd go around with a string of pack stock and have rations and grain. So we put the rations and grain in there. So if we had a surge or we needed to go in there and shovel the roofs in the winter, we'd have some extra grub in there. And then next spring, when we were in certain trails and we had a lot of gear, then we'd already have grain in there for the stock. We wouldn't have to be packing that around. So every fall, we'd kind of make this circuit, ration and grain cabins and then put up firewood. So we got in there. I'd probably need that shock collar. But in the front of these, like this logbook there was one I started. It was my writing on the outside, and you didn't tell one out, they didn't bring that one in. And I would always put old Alvo's quote in the front of that. And if there was a logbook already started and it didn't have anything in the front, I would then put that quote in. Just gotta remind folks what we were supposed to be doing out there. Now talk about this room, just like here. I'm getting on. Now, Jessica, you go a little farther, and you got to go look here, and around here. So that's why it kind of happens sometimes. I'm working out with Thoroughfare. This had been 1989, the year after the big fires. And I was down here patrolling the boundary by myself for about 3 weeks. And this particular day, we'll talk about, I was up on the trike. And you can see why they call it the trike. It's like these three bridges coming out, you know, kind of like, in like the prongs of a trident, and that's escarpment grid. And that's kind of what it looks like. This is the trident over here, and this is Thoroughfare Creek coming in, Ridger Lake, the Yellowstone coming in. The Park Service ranger station right in this by this meadow. Game and Fish has kept right down here, and Forest Service has kept over here. Kind of looking north on that big meadow towards Colton Peak. And this was a good place for me to glass, because you can see the boundary ran right across here, cut across the bottom of Falcon Creek, right up here. And we used to always call that where angels fly. If you stand up there, you can just see that that's kind of pretty much close to heaven you're going to get, probably. And there's kind of a little white view. I kind of tried to get this shaped up in Photoshop. But same kind of thing. This is the Triton. And that's protected. Then you kind of work your way up this ridge right here. And then right up here is where that one picture of me looking out over the valley was. And then you kind of work back in here, and the boundary cuts across the tops of Scarpin and Footprick. It's a pretty big country up there. And the day I was up there, it wasn't as nice as that. It was quite a bit more snow. And so this is a topo map of that, kind of where I went. This heavier mark is the regular system trail maintained by the Forest Service. And this is, like I was saying, kind of work my way up this ridge where you can look out. And kind of work my way back here to check this chunk of boundary there. You know, I'd use a laser printer, a laser pointer, by the way. Put my eye out, so I'm going to use this and then you kind of get on around here. I'm going to check this piece of boundary. And I did. I'm trying to shape, quicken this up a little bit. I did find where some guys have been in there. Just, your day just gets by. It's just big country up there, and there's a bunch of snow to kind of bust through. And so I was coming back. And I got about here, And I could see down the Draper Creek. I said, boy, that'd be easier traveling down there than kind of busting through all this snow. So I thought I'm just going to take a shortcut, put myself down this ridge and get out. Now, my wife, you know, she is what I would say shortcut, she would defer to my experience. Then she got a little more smarter. And nowadays, if I say the word shortcut, it's like, no shortcuts. Going back the way we know. Now, I can guarantee you, if she had been with me that day, I would have got back to the cabin. I'm lucky. Anyway, I start working down this ridge, and there's this rim of volcanic outcrop, and usually you can pick your way through, but I had a horse meal, and I just got rimmed out. I couldn't get through there. So I kind of went back. I saw another ridge, and I said, well, I think I can get off over there. So I went back down, got rimmed again, and it's getting pretty dark. And I had enough gear with me, because I always take enough gear to stay out a couple days in case I'd run into a poaching case over here. But I just kind of was too bullheaded at that time, and I was going to get back to the cabin. And so I noticed there was kind of some fingers of scree and timber, and so we just kind of bailed off, and the old horse was kind of going down on their haunches. And my idea was just to get below that rim rock and cut the contour around and hit the ridge and get out. Well, I ended up in the bottom, where you don't want to be, because it's kind of jungly down there. And this had actually turned in 89 to the year, 88 the year before. And it was dark by the time I got down. So I kind of got my pommel bag, get my flashlight out, find it. I looked in the saddle bags, couldn't find my flashlight. I looked at my day packs on my pack, of course, and couldn't find it. And I swear, I did this. I'm not kidding you. I went like this, and I could not see my hand from my face. And it's kind of overcast, and there's no moon. And so at first, I kind of started feeling my way, and I said, well, that's not going to cut it, really. You know, it's only about a mile and a half, and this is probably 7 o'clock at night. And so I had plenty of matches. So I light a match and kind of see where I was going, try to make one way. You know, light a piece of paper, and then, you know. And we weren't making much. And I thought, well, you know, my horse, yeah, he can see better than I can. And I know he's smart. So I get on top of him, and we're going a little bit. But he doesn't care if there's branches. I mean, he's just rolling. So he's like knocking me on the hoop, you know. So I kind of hunkered, tucked in on the side of that horse, and then humped my arm over the saddle horn, and he was beating me, but he was making a little time, but then he'd stop, and I'm sure he was thinking, like, what do you want me to do? Then I thought, well, you know, the mule, I bet he can see better than the horse and I, and I know he's smarter than either one of us. So I got him out going, and he got going, we made some time, and there's a little meadow right here, I was shooting for right in here, it didn't show up that way. I said, if I get there, you know, I kind of know a waypoint, kind of where I'm at, but, you know, it's probably getting 9, 10 o'clock now. And so we're going along, and all of a sudden I heard that mule's feet kind of splashing. Before I could move, do anything, that my horse just bailed in there, and it was in a bog, and boy, his front quarters went down. I was kind of like this, and I flop over in the bog, splashing there, and his hooves, he's trying to get out of this bog, and they're right by my head, and I can't see anything. But I get up and get the reins, and oh, anyway, we get kind of moving along pretty good. And, we hit this ridge, and it's not bad traveling. And all of a sudden, I realize I'm not getting pounded. So I stop and light a match, and there was a cut-face log, and that was the trail. Now, I was giving that mule a lot of credit, but he was going the wrong way. I don't know, maybe he just kind of knew where I needed to be in and out someday. I don't know. So, but anyway, we got turned around, and, you know, pretty much on autopilot then. We're just kind of cruising along. I'm cold and wet, but I had a pretty big smile on my face because I knew I was heading for home. And I could hear Nate Vance's, you know, bell mares over there. And his sun, I mean, the clouds have kind of broke a little bit, and stars have come out since I remember. I can see a little better. I don't know. And, you know, it's kind of one of those evenings. It would be nice to stop by woods and snow even. But I had miles to ride before I was going to sleep that night. So I got back to the range station. It's probably 1 o'clock in the morning. And, you know, it's dark. And there's a kennel up there on the cabin. Keep it locked up. So I tied up the hitch rack there and get my keys out of my pocket. And there was my flashlight. I had my flashlight with me the whole, I just never looked at my pocket. It's like, I never keep it there. I mean, and I have these shafts, and I just never, you know, I kind of just kind of think of those things as just the price of education. You know? Now I carry like two flashlights and a couple of headlamps. And, you know, they didn't have those nice little headlamps in heaven. I don't think about then, but. No, I pay a lot of money for college. I don't think I learned a lesson. So there you go. Say, we're getting, I needed that shock cover. Let's see where we're at here. We got some things we've done here. Okay. Well, I guess we'll talk a little about nature observations, since that was kind of part of the title here. Now, I suppose about most of you folks are probably teach me something about nature observation. But is anybody out there doing any hunting? Return in, you ain't hunting. Yeah. Anybody doing any fishing? Anybody doing any birding? Bird watching? Anybody get out with your camera or with nature and wildlife stuff? Anybody artists? Yeah, I don't think as many as letting on. Because I see Jim Bam out there, now he's a famous artist, and his wife, Lynn, she's a published poet, and I see it, my wife's a poet, and you know, I see poet, I see a musician, Jeff back there, he's an amazing musician. And so I think, you know, there's quite a few artists out there, I think. And, you know, I think, I forgot about my pictures, haven't I? There's up on the front, you can see it kind of frosty looking at sometimes. Well, here we go. You know, some of my best nature experiences have been out when I've been out hunting or fishing or bird watching or photographing. Now, I'm not much of an artist. I'm not much for making up poems or painting pictures, and I have absolutely no musical ability. But here we are, you're out hunting one day, and then here's these three little red-tailed hawks I'm looking at through a spot and scope, and here's Chuck and I out photographing eagle nests. And now down here is a picture by Vincent van Gogh, wheat field with crows. Now, I suppose folks would say, oh, that doesn't look too much like the wheat fields, and it doesn't look too much like crows. But, you know, I'd like to pack that original in Antiques Roadshow and have them tell me how much that was worth. But talking about artists, there's old Vincent van Gogh and some pictures he painted. You know, artists really, I think, are some of the best nature observers. I mean, that's kind of their job, you know? To see the world and kind of interpret and give us some clues on we might see a little different. Now, some of them, you know, it's kind of rough on them, like old Vincent there. You know, they don't last too long sometimes. And, you know, I figure maybe, you know, sometimes too much coming out of them. Maybe the spring's a little too vibrant, or maybe the winter's a little too dark. And, you know, probably just drives them crazy. You know, a little lithium or Prozac probably wouldn't hurt old Vincent. Then we might have to have some of these nice pictures. You know, here 120 years later, we still kind of get clues on how to see the world. But, you know, talking about crazy artists and things kind of remind me of those little caribou we have in Alaska. And, you know, they'd bunch up in the summer and there'd be a cloud of mosquitoes around them, and they'd just keep driving crazy, and they'd go one way or another, and they'd go up on snow fields, and they'd be swimming out in lakes, and, you know, they'd just try to get away. And I suppose daggone, that's probably what old Vincent did, too. But, thinking about those, let's see if we can get that clip. Now this is a clip of film of Dick training. And this was a film that was made in the 70s. And this is actually Dick talking versus the one you see on PBS, which is Bob Swear talking.
Well, I think the caribou is bothered more by insects than any other big game animal in the next country. The insects bother them to such an extent that they will just take off and run, sometimes in one direction and then just turn around and run in the other direction just to create a breeze to get rid of these insects. About the first days of summer, that's when the big herd is formed, you know, cows and calves, and there's some bulls in a bunch. From this big herd, small bunches will split off and come up the into Twin Lakes country, up along the lower lake, the upper lake, and up into the high mountains above. After the snow is gone in the low country, they go to the high country to rest on the snow patches up there where the insects are not a bother. In order to get both, I aim to move while they're moving, because they only detect movement. If they're moving when you're moving, they won't notice you, but if they're standing still and you move, they'll spot you right away. While caribou will lie down, and oftentimes they'll stretch out and lay flat. I've seen maybe a group of a dozen that would just lay out flat, and you would swear that it was all dead.
Show you a little piece of video that I took of Dick and I one day, over a couple days, but I was going up to investigate a plane crash up on Low Pass, and well, of course, Dick, you want to go along, so sure, oh, come on. So this is where me and Dick, we're heading up, and we're up at Low Pass. This is Twin Lakes, and the ranger cabin is right down here in the bay. That's where my ranger cabin was. I'd come up late, and Dick's cabin was on up.
Trouble is, all shooting already been done off to a tripod.
Just give me a little photography lesson.
So what's the story here, Dick?
The man has been standing there for 10,000 years. I wish I could see what he has seen in his lifetime. In time lapse. See it in 10 minutes. 10,000 years reduced to 10 minutes. That would be a pretty good deal, huh?
What do you say to him every time you come by?
Swordfish.
What's he say? That's the man on the mountain. So we've walked up here the last 2 days in a row, huh, Dick? Dick's heading down the hill. And there's the boat. Dick actually walked from his house today.
One of my favorite pictures of Dick. I took him. I'm sure he's just telling me some really interesting thing. I mean, he's just happy it's full of it. But he's got that stick there, and you know, one day I said, "Hey, Dick, you got a nice stick. Boy, no, does that make you want?" So Dick helped me make this stick, and it's got one of my prized possessions. There he is. First years I was up on Tlalpan, that's kind of looking up Tlalpan Lake, and all right. Well, we're about to get through this first section here. So we can take a little break here if we want to get here in a few minutes. But anyway, I'm going to try something here. Hope it's speaking challenge for me. I'm going to get a drink. But anyway, going back to artists. You know, I'm going down the trail. You know, you get a little tune in your head or a poem. And don't have to worry about me singing. But one of the poems that, you know, always kind of came to me, like I said earlier, is Robert Frost stopping by woods on a snowy evening. And I'd like just try to say that. Because when I say it, it kind of takes me out there. If I read it, it would kind of take me down here. And I just shoot me out there. But, you know, when I'm on the trail by myself, it doesn't matter if I get the words right. But here, I probably should do a little better. But if I don't, you can say what they are. All right, I'm going to give this a go. Stopping by woods on a snowy evening by Robert Frost. Whose woods these are, I think I know. This house is in the village, though. You won't see me stopping here. See his woods go up the snow. My little horse, this thing is square. Stopped without a farmhouse near, between the woods and frozen lake. Dark as he took here. Gives his harness bell a shake. To ask if there's some mistake. Only another sound's a sweep. Easy wind. Oh, the woods are lovely, dark and deep. But I have promises. Miles right across me. Lunchtime, so I can understand. You know, you can just kind of act like you're going to go out there and go to the bathroom. You're never going to act. You're not going to hurt my feelings, but since I'm all suited up here and I got all this stuff done, folks that want to go a little longer down the trail, we'll just keep on going. What we got next? Well, these are some pretty pictures stirred up here. But my mother suffered a stroke about 2.5 years ago, and affected the left side of her brain. And which works the right side of your body, so you know, I get around very good anymore. And one tougher thing was what really affected her speech. And I got to looking into brain, so, you know, I'm back in college days, I had anatomy and physiology, but I hadn't that much. So I started reading up on different things about the brain, and I got to kind of realizing how that kind of works when you're out in nature and the natural world, where I am a lot. And crossed. Let me see, what am I next? Okay, there's your brain if you forgot what it looks like. It looks broke to me. It's got a big split down the middle of it. We don't look at that. Look at something nicer. Anyway, I got to reading about some books. And most of the books I read didn't have a lot of pictures in it. I like the books with pictures. Anyway, anybody ever read this book? Okay. Well, this is by Jill Bolton Taylor, and she was a neuroanatomist at Harvard. She called herself a brain scientist. I'm going to go with brain science, that's easier to say. And I figured, you know, she was a scientist at Harvard. She has to be a fairly square with human being. I mean, it wasn't a book by just some yahoo that wanted to make some money. So I got kind of interested in this, and Jill Bolton Taylor had a stroke on the left side of her brain. And so that was kind of tying in with what happened to my mother. And she was getting ready to go to work at Harvard one day. And she woke up and had a headache. She started to shake it off, doing a little exercise. And then she got in the shower. And then things started going a little haywire for her. And I'm just going to pull up, I think I got some excerpts from her book. Here we go. I'm going to let you read that because you don't really want me to read it. And she says that, talking about her left brain, right brain, you know, she just kind of felt at one with the workers. And she really couldn't kind of, you know, she couldn't really tell where she ended in the shower. She kind of blended in. And she talks about, you know, that kind of brain shatter in your mind. Maybe you got it all right. You know, you got a mad about something or thinking about something. And you know, when you're talking on the cell phone and driving, when you're talking, you don't see as much. And it's kind of about the same way with that brain chatter. And she was also just kind of living in the moment. You know, she didn't know what happened before and what was going to happen. So she just kind of had the moment. And you had that, you know, just that silence. You said it almost was seductive. But now I was thinking, you know, she kind of was getting this one with the universe feeling. She was living in the moment. And she had that brain chatter quieting down. But, you know, it's kind of what I try to do. I'm not very good at it. I don't think much of a stroke to get there. But, you know, there's, you know, we kind of try to do those things. Which is in there. So she also goes into, she's a brain scientist, so she knows all about this. And so she talks about left mind, right mind. And, you know, the left brain, I guess, is where that language goes. And my mother had a stroke on the left side. Boy, she just can't get her words out. And you just think, in our, you know, mechanized, digitized, sanitized world, you know, you don't, that part doesn't get too much. You wake up in the morning and you got to talk to your spouse, or you turn the radio on, turn, read a newspaper, whatever, and boy, it's pretty much like that all day long. And so you go to bed at night, you pull off the TV, you go to bed, or lay there and read a book, so you got those language part going all the time anymore. And then that's also the part that's got linear time, past, present, future, kind of sequential events. And again, that doesn't get much break anymore. I can guarantee you, I've got six folks taking care of my mother, and I look at the calendar a lot. But also, that's a part of the brain that sees the world in parts. You know, saying can't see the forest for the trees. Well, I guess the left brain's got to see the trees. And if you're a forester, that's probably a pretty good thing. But you know, when you kind of see the world as parts, you kind of see yourself as the second part. And then you might think, well, you know, those people out there probably could help this part. You want to take care of this part because it's the only one you got. But, you know, being a separate part, you know, sometimes it can be a little lonely, too. But now the right brain, it communicates in images, and feelings, and sensations. And you never think back of a good time or a bad time. It usually kind of comes back in images that are just images and feelings. And you don't really think it was 1986 at 8 o'clock in the afternoon. You just maybe have a good feeling in your chest, or maybe a not so good feeling in your stomach. I got to think back, you know, kind of left mind, the language versus feelings. That have you ever eaten something like frog legs or rattlesnake or alligator? What do people say that tastes like?
Chicken.
Yeah. You know, you taste something, your right brain says, well, that's different. Your right brain says, no, it's chicken. Your left brain says, no, it's chicken. Your right brain says, no, it's not chicken. And your left brain says, no. Oh, we only got one word for it. It's chicken. Let's go with it. Your right brain says, no, it's not chicken. Well, the right brain also kind of lives in the moment, kind of like Joe Montana, but just kind of in the moment, you know? And, you know, in hunting or birding or wildlife photography, especially patience is a really good thing to be able to get a hold of. And, you know, if you're not worried about what you didn't do or what you got to do, patience is a little bit easier to come by. And also, they said right mind kind of sees the world as a whole. You know, you're just kind of looking out there, just this whole big thing. And you kind of realize that, you know, you're kind of part of that whole. And you kind of made you think, well, stuff that you two is over here might really be kind of known to you. And a quote from, you know, again, I'm sure most of you have heard it, from one of our more prominent Native Americans comes to mind. Old Chief Seattle there. I kind of feel like old Chief Seattle looks sometimes. I've got this document too. But way back in the 1850s, you know, Chief Seattle says, humankind has not woven the web of life. We are but one thread within it. Whatever we do to the web, we do to ourselves. All things are bound together. All things connect. Well, I like to come to this moment. But you know, every once in a while, us humans, you kind of get to think, you know, we're kind of running this show here. And if I go over to Yellowstone, I'll be, you know, and say, oh, you know, you need to fiddle with this a little bit, you need to fiddle with that. If you're around long enough, you know, like I was 27 years ago, you know, somebody just moves right back where it was and move it back to another place where it was before. And, you know, there's sometimes when you know, you have some close calls, and, you know, there's been several times when I've, you know, came a nose hair from getting killed or busted up. And, you know, either, you know, treated by a grizzly bear or chased by a grizzly bear on horseback or about to drug to death by a horse or, you know, going over a cliff with my horse or going in airplanes and helicopters to kind of, yeah, you know, close calls. You know, after one of those, kind of the dust settles a little bit. Heart rate goes down a bit. A line from one of my favorite books comes to mind. And that's, life is life, fun is fun. It's all so quiet. I suppose it is. And that comes from a book by Beryl Martin. Bless with an A. Anybody read that book? That's a good book. Now, there's a ton of good quotes in that book. You got to, you know, quotes, and you can pull up a bunch. That brings you back to a little bit of humbleness there. So now this kind of wraps up that personal section. So, where are we at here? It's a little over one already. So, why don't we take a couple questions, and folks can, you know, leave if they want to, and then if anybody wants to stay away, we'll stay on, we'll go down the trail farther, we'll just go on. Yeah.
What is the most important thing that you feel you've learned as a in your backcountry experience?
I don't know, you know, actually I probably would say just kind of being flexible. You know, not having those schedules, you know. Just kind of doing what you need to do when the weather permits. Just, you know, kind of a little bit flow with things. You know, nowadays, you're like, you know, I have some people say, you know, I've got 30 minutes on Thursday, I can meet with you. Like, if that's all you got, woo! I don't want your life. But anyway, anybody else? Yeah, Joe.
Richard, I used to do what you did. So, you know that brick wall you hit when you've been out there 10 days and you're required to come back in to report to somebody that you're still alive, and you hear that first sound of recognized world, that you go, are you sure you want to go back into that?
Oh, yeah. There's a little clip of Dick says that exact same thing in this way. It's like, once you're out there, just don't, you know, you don't want to come back. In Alaska, sometimes they call it, you know, getting a little bushy. I had a picture of me getting a little bushy. And you know, you go down that trail far enough, and it's hard to find your way back. You run into some of those little bush rats out there. It's like once you start hearing that sound of traffic, it's like, I think I'm just going to be around all that. Anybody else? Let's actually end the second one. We don't have any more to go.
Thank you.
God knows some folks are retired, but I don't have it. You know, any promises to keep this afternoon? So we got maybe another 10 minutes or so if you want to stay alone. You gotta let people get settled down there. Anybody else got a question when we're doing this?
Who did you work for when you were in Alaska?
I'm sorry?
Who did you work for?
I worked for the National Park Service in the summertime, and I worked for Governor Hammond in the wintertime. All right, well, looks like a few folks are going to gut it out. So. Like I said, I'm all suited up here, so what the heck. So when you had this quote, going back to this quote here, the word quiet, and that's kind of what Joe's talking about. You know, I don't think a lot of folks really know what quiet sounds like. You know, and Emily really kind of mentioned this, so we can blame her for credit her. Let's just take, where are we getting folks settled down? Let's take 30 seconds and just see if we can just be as quiet as we can be, just for 30 seconds. And not only physically quiet, but see if you can get that brain chatter quiet down and not have a single thought in your mind for 30 seconds. All right. Let's go. Okay. Hey, that's in my long time. Your life was like 10 30 seconds. You may have, like, have a long life. Now, was that pretty quiet?
Yes, you got that.
And you can hear the fan, you can hear people kind of shuffling around a little bit. Yeah, very few people have really heard quiet. And you know, you can do that around here. I'll go out and sometimes stay on a YU bench out in the desert. And it's amazing, but you don't hear traffic a lot of times. You can go big chunks of time without even hearing any traffic. And that's the thing, you know, I've been on hikes with folks, and I bet there's not 30 seconds somebody's not talking. It's like, oh, I guess we're not going to see much today, you know? And so you can kind of be physically quiet and not talk, not bust through the brush, but quiet that brain chatter. That's the thing that can be tough to quiet down. And just like I was talking earlier about a cell phone. You got that going on in your mind. When I would be out, let me see here. Yeah, I think I spent about half of my life looking through binoculars and spots. And you know, I'd be out there glassing the boundary or something, and I had something going on in my brain. And, I wouldn't see as much. So you know, historically, we've kind of tried to shut that brain chatter down. You know, like, count backwards from 100, count sheep at night, try to quiet your brain out so you go to sleep. Or, you know, different religions. Maybe you'll have a little repetitive prayer. It's just kind of going on. What's it kind of doing? It's kind of, you know, I think kind of pushing that brain chatter out so you can kind of maybe just think just for 30 seconds something maybe a little more important. Or in the Eastern religions, like, or with yoga or meditation, you know, there's a thing called the mantra. It's another little repetitive sound or little phrase you say. And that's good. It's just kind of trying to push that out so you can have just a little quiet, just for a while. My mantra is freeze up. You want to hear a story about how I got my mantra? Good. This is pretty sort of I practiced this. Anyway, let's see what we got here. Okay, when that's first summer up in Alaska. You ever seen that movie Never Cry Wolf? Yeah, and they just dumped, that's what they did. They just dumped my stuff out, left me, and said, we'll never had anybody up here before, just see what's going on. Just throw me in a briar patch. And had this little Timba tin cabin, porcupines, and fin chewing on it. And they slapped the Park Service in the lake. And you know, that whole summer, I was, you know, around this lake a lot. And you're always having kind of lake motion, and lake sounds, and lake smells, you know, just a lot going on. Then in September, they came in and said, we're going to pull you out here in a week, get your stuff gathered up and squared away and shut down the cabin. And I said, I don't really want to leave. Now, I got plenty of food. Now, I got more food down in the village cache. You can just bring it to me. And now, we're going off floats. You know, we won't be able to come back and get you until the ice is frozen up to land the airplane on. I'm thinking to myself, what? Well, that October, it got pretty cold. It actually got more cold than usual. And it got down to 20, 30, 40, and I saw it at 44 below zero in October. But that lake would just not freeze. If it went, you didn't get some ice, then you get a big wind coming down, and it would bust up. And it would be 40 below zero air temperature and 32 degree water. That's a 70 degree differential. And it would just steam. And I was in this fog at 40 below zero. And I could see out the end of the lake. It was a beautiful blue sky day. But I was in a fog. And every once in a while, I'd hike up this ridge here. You know, kind of get up there and see out and see some sunshine. And be all soft in that blow. Well, that lake finally got cold enough. And we got a little stretch of calm weather. And that lake froze up. I looked out one morning and rose up clear across that lake. That's nice. The thing I noticed, you know, I'd go out there and stand. Just out in front of my cabin, 40 below zero. And I just stand there, and you just kind of want to take the whole thing in, you know? And maybe, you know, you kind of feel that 40 below bite gets out of your nose, your cheek, eyes water a little bit, sparkles in the air from the frozen moisture crystal in the first rays of light. Well, I just stand there. Stand there. Quite a while. You can get lots of appointments. Maybe that person could freeze to death. So I'd go in the cabin. So I'd go and have a cup of coffee. That's the story. I got my monitor. Soak it all in, you know, it's just too big. And but you want to. You want to see that, you just kind of feel it. You know, you are kind of like it. But a little technique sometimes I use out there is I'll just try to spread my vision out. And with glasses, I can try to see outside of my glasses or above. And you know, I can see both my fingers moving right now. I can see this one better, but I didn't have a different gut out there. You know, so just standing there, without moving, I can see a big chunk of country. And if I just kind of move my head, real slow, and pull that vision out, keep it pulled out, it's kind of hard. Keep that pulled out. You know, I can see 360, I can see things behind me. And some of you might not want to do this, you know, walking at first. That's kind of hard. Really. Your left brain saying, I want to see that. I need to see that. I can't see anything. But if you kind of just pull your vision out and then kind of breathe slow, kind of notice what you're smelling, maybe like seed, pine, then open your ears up. It's kind of omnidirectional. That kind of pull your attention out, too. It just all kind of pulls out. You're kind of seeing everything, and you're seeing 360. And you say, well, you can't see anything, but I can guarantee you, you do that, you scan, and like I've scanned with a spotting scope. And a spotting scope is easier than binoculars, but you can see that full vision, and you can spread your vision out in that easier. And boy, you just keep scanning, and something changes out there. Maybe a little bunch of elk comes out of the timber, or a rider comes out on the ridge. Well, you'll pick that up. And so you can really actually see a lot if you can kind of let your mind get trained into doing that. You know, like fire lookouts. I have good friends of mine that have on fire lookouts for 40 years. And they get to look at all these little places. They just scan. What if there was something different that picked up right there? So, you know, that's kind of something you can do too. And like I said, you know, you might not want to, you know, you might just want to stop and practice that a little bit. But then, you know, you get to going. And you can do that. And, you know, I can see that trail up. And if you know there's a rock down there, you can look down or root and you step over it. You know, and you kind of pull that vision out, and you can still see those things. And what times I'll do, I'll slow down, but I got using tracking poles, and I started noticing when I was cross-country skiing, I was keeping my head up more, seeing more. So I started using tracking poles when I was hiking. And at first I thought, that looks kind of funny. But, you know, if you trip on something, you got something to catch yourself with. And just going slow anyway. And that's kind of like, you know, being in the moment. You know, because if you're just in the moment, you know, it doesn't matter how far you went or how far you got to go. Where you're at right here may just be as good as it gets. You know? So, me know if you have a chance. You know, maybe just your little thing, stop and smell roses. Good.
If you can't stop, maybe we can slow down a bit.
You just kind of try to get that great chatter quieted down, and kind of, you know, connected this one with the world thing going for you, and you know, just kind of be in the moment just for a little bit. And you know, kind of brings me back to a time when I think we're getting close to that one there, Bunny. You know, going down the trail, and it'll be a blue sky day and some clouds, and you're gonna go down and you're gonna smell the pine and the spruce, and maybe there's some wild roses there, or patch of bluebells, and you know, maybe a squall comes through and the rainbow comes out, and you're going down the trail on your pony and you're kind of getting that rhythm going, or maybe you're walking, kind of getting that rhythm going, and like me, especially with my pony, and you're kind of feeling that one with the pony, and then you kind of feel one with stuff and start getting that connected thing going clear out there. And, you know, tune, going back to artists, at the very end here, there's a tune comes to mind, and sometimes when I'm out there, I think of the tune, and sometimes when I'm here, that tune takes me back out there. So let's see, that's another one of our famous artists. And we just say, what about Lou? You know, you can get some of these with pictures and stuff, but I think old Louie's bright eyes and bright face, but this is the business.
What a wonderful life. I see trees of green. I see them blue for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Days, dark, sacred nights, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, say, how do you do?
You got that thing latched on you to write brain this afternoon. That's right now such a bad thing. So I'd like to thank you all for coming along with it. Some of you stuck it out. So, thanks, guys.